Fantastic. So because of security, yeah, we our policy is we always have two workers in each of the rooms. So not only do we need the primary teacher, but we need the assistant in each of those. It's a great need. We want to be excellently positioned so that when any next-gen families come to visit the chapel, they say they are ready to help. Come alongside me and raise my kids up in the fear and admonition of who God is, that they might have this spiritual foundation that will serve them the rest of their lives. It's a huge priority for us here at the chapel. So please pray with us to that end. And as you've just heard the challenge, consider how you or someone you know, it's always easier to volunteer somebody you know, right? Somebody else. So be thinking about that. In fact, let's pray to that end. Heavenly Father, thanks so much for Jim and Cindy Lombardo. Thanks for their kids and how they've grown up here. And thank you for their heart to serve you by serving these little ones. Thanks for the ones who are right now taking care of the kids and providing security for the kids and providing all of the resources. And we would love to see a Holy Spirit movement of next-gen families come this way. But Holy Spirit, you have to be the one who connects them here. You have to be the one who stirs these dear people to serve them, to teach them, to love them, to pray with them, to disciple them. And so we're asking that you would do that. Thank you for generations of, well, we just heard, little pastors who have been raised up who understand your love. We praise you that the faith is simple enough for a child to accept and profound enough that none of us feel like we have grasped the width and the depth and the height and the breadth of your love for us. And as we do, Holy Spirit, would you open our spiritual eyes and ears today? Would you reveal your glory to us at least a little bit more? And would you bring about the transformation in our lives that would please you and bless people around us? So we've come to meet with you, living God of the universe. Thank you that you'll receive our worship. Thank you that you are our teacher, Holy Spirit. We're ready to give you our best. In Jesus' name, amen. Turn in your Bibles, if you would, please, to John chapter 3. And actually, by way of setup, we love things that are great. We love people that are great, people that excel, people that are the best at what they do. I mean, it just gets our attention and it captures our best creative energies. But when it comes to greatness in God's sight, who comes to mind? Who do you think is great in God's sight? Is it the person with the biggest bank account, the person who has the most people reporting to him or her? Is it the person with the highest GPA? What determines greatness? Well, that's a question we all ought to ask. It's a question the disciples were asking, right? Hey, when it comes to the kingdom, who's going to sit at your right hand? Who's going to sit at your left hand? Who's going to be greatest in the kingdom of heaven? Well, Jesus answered that question for us. And he said, when it comes to those born among women, born from women, which is pretty much everybody, right? There is none greater than John the Baptist. And so that's who we're going to look at today, John the Baptist. We met him in John chapter 1, but our text is John chapter 3, beginning in verse 22. And it's interesting because John is not the person that we would identify as the greatest. I mean, he probably wouldn't even make the list. The movers and shakers in Jerusalem in the first century definitely would have left John off the list, or at least he would have been way down at the bottom. But here's how he's introduced in John chapter 1. There was a man named John who was sent from God. He came as a witness to testify about the light so that all might believe through him. So, class, who is the light? Well, let me read on. This is John 1, but I'll get to John 3 in just a moment. Now, the witness was not the light, but he came to testify about the true light who gives light to everyone was coming into the world. So, who is the light, class? Jesus. That's exactly right. And as John is introduced, we see a significant contrast between the master and the messenger, John the Baptist. John was a man, but Jesus is God incarnate. John was a witness, but Jesus is introduced as the Word of God, the expression of all of the essence of the infinite God. John was a servant, but Jesus is the Son. And again and again and again, he talks about his special relationship with the Father. And so when we turn to John chapter 3, we are presented with his purpose. John's purpose was to prepare the way. Just as the prophet Isaiah had said hundreds of years before the time of Christ that one would come and proclaim the day of the Lord and challenge people to prepare the way for the Lord, that's John. And he understood something of his purpose. In fact, he said over in Matthew chapter 3, "Now I baptize you with water for repentance, but the one who is coming after me is more powerful than I. I am not worthy to remove his sandals. He himself will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire." Water baptism is significant. It's interesting. It gets our attention. I mean, when we lift the screen there and fill the tank with water and somebody goes public about their testimony of salvation through faith in Christ, that's huge. But I don't think that begins to compare to baptism with, what does it say? With fire and the Holy Spirit? Oh, my word! Well, if you know what comes next after the crucifixion, the resurrection, the ascension, Jesus said, "I will go away and I'll send another comforter to you, the Holy Spirit." John's gospel is going to talk a lot about the Holy Spirit and our relationship with him in subsequent chapters. But here it is. He says, here's the one I'm talking about. This is how great he is. I'm preparing the way for the one who is greater than I am. So John chapter 3 and verse 22. "Now Jesus and his disciples went to the Judean countryside." So Jesus grew up in Nazareth to the north. A lot of his gospel ministry took place up around the Galilee, which has been termed the Gospel Triangle. And we've looked at that on the map before. We'll look at it again. But so much of what Jesus did was up there near Cana and Capernaum. And now he comes. He had come in chapter 2 down to the temple for one of the great religious festivals. But now he's left the temple and he's out in the Judean countryside. And he's baptizing? That's interesting. What was that about? He hadn't been crucified. He hadn't been resurrected. He hadn't given the Great Commission, go into all the world, make disciples of all nations, and baptize them into the name of the Father, Son, and the Spirit. So what was he doing here? Christian baptism wasn't yet in practice, right? What did this baptism signify? Was it that people were followers of Jesus? No, because John the Baptist was baptizing before Jesus ever showed up at the Jordan River. This was a baptism of repentance. It was a symbol indicating that people were ready to turn from some of their evil practices in order to be spiritually prepared for the kingdom of God that was being announced as at hand. So if the kingdom of God is showing up, you want to make sure that you're ready for it, that you've got things in order, right? And so that required a repentance, a turning from evil ways to right ways. And so those who heard that message and were responsive were participating in this baptism of repentance. So let's keep reading. Verse 23, "John was also baptizing near Enon, near Salim, because there was plenty of water there." So you get the picture? Jesus and his disciples are baptizing. John and his disciples are baptizing. People were coming, verse 23, and being baptized, since John had not yet been thrown into prison. That comes later. Verse 25, "Then a dispute arose between John's disciples and a Jew about purification." Usually when it identifies a Jew, I mean, most of these were Jews. So why is this one called a Jew? Probably because of his emphasis on the law. He may have been a religious Jewish leader who comes to say, hey, this you're not doing this purification stuff right. Well, think about it. Does baptism purify the body? We just use tap water back there. And I've baptized people in white water, rivers, in salt water, in the ocean, in their backyard pond. And that's probably dirty water. So the point of baptism isn't to purify the body. It doesn't purify the soul. These people were all about ritual purification. But baptism can't wash away sin. So it's obvious they were having this dispute about how to be right. Verse 26, so they came to John the Baptist, and told him, Rabbi, the one you testified about, behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. Remember that testimony? The one who was with you across the Jordan is baptizing, and now everyone's flocking to him. What's going on? The Baptist's followers are jealous. Hey, they were on our side of the river. Now they're all crossing over, and they're following Jesus and his disciples. There's a jealousy here. And it's interesting, the impulse to follow a charismatic religious leader is with us today as much as it was in the first century, right? Where's the latest show in town? Who's got the newest gimmicks? Who's got the best band? Who's got the most dynamic testimonies? Who's got the most impressive preacher? And that points out to us a dangerous tendency in religion to look to a man as opposed to Jesus, the God-man, the Son of God. I mean, consider some of the religious celebrities that are known around our nation, and consider how some of them, too many of them, have fallen. We ought never to look to a person, because you will always be disappointed, and what you're looking at is always so far short of who God wants us to see. He sends Jesus to our midst. Then the Holy Spirit comes that we might know God the Father through God the Son. And it's never about a man. I am so glad I am not having to deal with this notion of, oh, Rob, everybody thinks you're so great. John the Baptist responds, I'm not the source of anything. Look to the one who is from heaven. God is in control. He can handle this. Verse 27, look at how he says it. John says, no one can receive a single thing unless it's given to him from heaven. So people who were here and now are there, God's in control of that. I suppose that applies to our church family. I look through my records of people who have worshiped with us here in the last decade. Phenomenal people, so committed to God, and it hurts a little. I'm a little jealous for their participation in our church family when I consider them going elsewhere. And then I realize, but the people God has here are way better. I'm not making those kinds of judgment statements, okay? And God moves people around where he will. We can't keep all the best people here. And I'm so glad for every person that God sends our way. It's no accident that you are here today. So no one has anything unless it's been given to him from God. Verse 28, you yourselves can testify, the Baptist said, that I am not the Messiah, but I've been sent ahead of him. Here again, John speaks to his purpose, preparing the way for the Messiah, the Savior of the world. Now, physical preparation, if an important dignitary were coming, say, from Rome, it wasn't unusual to hire slave labor to move huge boulders out of the way, to fill in ruts, to make sure that the path was straight and level, that he or she would have a comfortable procession. So that's how you would prepare the road physically. How do you prepare the road spiritually when there's word going about that the kingdom of heaven is at hand? Well, it has to do with this notion of repentance. Repentance is that 180-degree change of thinking about God and sin. We begin, usually, depending on how inculcated we are by culture, by thinking, well, I'm a pretty good person, and God must be pretty pleased to have me on his team. And then we start to understand the holiness, the infinite majesty of God, that he is completely apart from sin. And we start to recognize, in light of his holiness, my shortcomings, my imperfections, my utter moral failure in God's sight. Repentance is when we start to understand, oh, God's displeased with my sin. No, it's actually more, God finds my sin abhorrent, and I need to turn from it and find his forgiveness. Repentance starts in the mind and the heart, but eventually repentance will always manifest itself in changed behavior. Now, the Bible doesn't give us a time frame for that. Do we have to turn from our sin in a day, in a week, in a month, in a year, in a decade? It doesn't say. But it does say that the fruit of repentance, a changed behavior, will become manifest. It will become evident eventually. Sometimes it happens immediately, sometimes it takes a long time as the Holy Spirit works on us. This is significant, though, that we don't have to wait to get our act together, to turn from all of our sin, before we could choose to follow Christ. And that's really good news, because you can't get it all together. Not enough to please God. None of us can get our act together before we choose to follow Christ. So we make that faith leap. I do believe. Would you please forgive me? And then the Holy Spirit comes in and he gives us a new nature and he begins to transform us and do this work of repentance and transformation. It's like the employee who steals company time. Day after day, week after week, thinking, hey, I can get by with this. And then when the Holy Spirit comes in and transforms them, in this grace of repentance, they start to understand the scriptures that say, whatever you do, do it wholeheartedly as unto the Lord. And they say, oh, if I'm getting paid for 8 hours, I ought to give 8 hours of effort. And so I'm going to turn from that and try and honor God. The illustrations are endless, and right now I imagine the Holy Spirit's bringing something to your mind, but celebrate the fact that we don't have to get our act together before we can follow Christ. But once we follow Christ, the Holy Spirit does this work that generates repentance, and that will be evident in our lives over a period of time. So John's purpose is to prepare the way. And then as we read on, he addresses his passion and the passion of the Messiah. Look at verse 29. He who has the bride is the groom. We get that. But the groom's friend, his attendant, the best man who stands by and listens for him, rejoices greatly at the groom's voice. All the attention's on the groom. So this joy of mine is complete. There's a lot of passion in this picture here. And the picture is that Jesus is the groom who is coming and that his followers are the bride. Verse 29 here is pointing to all the Old Testament imagery of God's love for his people. Again and again in the Old Testament, the Spirit uses this analogy, an analogy that the people could well understand to depict his relationship with his chosen people. It's quite graphic. The idea is that Israel was chosen by God, that Israel was betrothed to God, promised to have a special relationship, that God lavished his covenant love upon Israel. But Israel was unfaithful, and God refers to Israel as adulteress. He uses this graphic term that talks about a physical relationship, but he applies it to the spiritual relationship between Israel and himself. In fact, the prophet Ezekiel speaks in the most vivid language. I mean, this would definitely be rated TV 14 or for mature audiences only. Here's what Ezekiel says. God is speaking through his servant and says, then I passed by you and I saw you, and you were indeed at the age for love. So I spread the edge of my garment over you and covered your nakedness. This is God's heart for his people Israel. I pledged myself to you, entered into a covenant with you, and you became mine. This is the declaration of the Lord God. I adorned you with jewelry, putting bracelets on your wrists and a chain around your neck. I put a ring in your nose, earrings on your ears, and a beautiful tiara on your head. I mean, he's lavishing the love of his life with all of these blessings. Verse 14, your fame spread among the nations because of your beauty, for it was perfect through my splendor, which I had bestowed on you. This is the declaration of the Lord God. But Ezekiel goes on to say, you were confident in your beauty and acted like a prostitute because of your fame. Israel acting like a prostitute? Instead of returning God's love, Israel loved other false gods. You lavished your sexual favors on everyone who passed by you. Your beauty became his. You also took your beautiful jewelry made from the gold and silver I had given you, and you made male images so that you could engage in prostitution with them. I told you this is rated for adults. This is God's message for his people through Israel. I mean, through Ezekiel to Israel. And this graphic picture reveals how Israel turned her passions away from God. John's passion was to point to God's passion for his people. Fortunately, in his incredible mercy, God does not let his people continually wander away towards destruction. In fact, many of the prophets pick up on this theme of God's passionate love for his people. The Old Testament prophet Hosea wrote about Israel's unfaithfulness and about God's covenant love for his people. It became very personal to Hosea because his wife stepped out on him continually, repeatedly in adultery. Watch this video portrayal, a modern depiction of how heartbreaking that was. It's hard to watch. Makes me feel dirty. And that's nothing compared to the book of Hosea. Read that this week and you'll be heartbroken. Israel was like a bride that God lavished his love upon, but all of her idolatry was like adultery to God. Hosea repeatedly went out after his wife, and she repeatedly spurned his love. Just like God continually pursues us when we love something or someone more than him. Now, this love story would have come to mind to every Jew who heard John's talk of the groom and the bride. Verse 29, he who has the bride is the groom, but the groom's friend who stands by and listens for him rejoices greatly at the groom's voice, so this joy of mine is complete. He's saying Jesus is the groom. Those who will follow him, who will love him, are his bride, and I'm just the attendant to the groom. He's the man of the hour, right? And he's come to reveal God's love for you. So John says, this isn't about me. He's the one you should be focusing on. Verse 30, he must increase, I must decrease. Now, our natural inclination is to advance our cause, to promote ourselves, to get ahead, to get more, to increase, whatever it takes. But here is a radical reorientation that begins at salvation. When we die to self and start to live for the Lord, we live for his greater glory. So that puts a whole different perspective on our pursuit of popularity, on our pride in personal accomplishments, on our self-righteousness. Check out this man's testimony regarding self-righteousness.
I struggled with basically self-righteousness before I started walking with Jesus. I kind of thought what a lot of people think, which is that religious answers are just attempts to try to explain the unknowable. I very rarely talked about Jesus in a personal way. I've always talked about it in a very conceptual way. I kind of thought before, whatever was out there, whatever people were talking about, that was all fine and good. I just didn't need it. Like, I had my own basis for how to live, and I had a basic sense of what was right and what was wrong. And that was enough. I had kind of my own morality starter kit. And what changed was my awareness that, oh no, I was not where I thought I was. That I was in more need of an internal renovation than I had ever believed or thought. I totally bought into the societal expectations and beliefs about goodness. I thought I had it. I thought it was within me, and it wasn't. I didn't have all of the tools and the skills and the perspective that I thought I had. And even when I was doing good, oh my gosh, it was like sometimes what was my motivation? We can't be our own point of reference for fairness or goodness because we have a tendency to want to choose whatever is going to benefit us the most. Like, I can't trust myself to be the sole arbiter of truth. I have to find some other source. And that epiphany was what caused me to start ask and examine who Jesus is or what goodness is in a different way. What I found was that Jesus is both the source of what good is and my power source of being able to actually accomplish the things that he defines as good. That's, to me, the turning point of who Jesus is.
He must increase, I must decrease. John was passionate about communicating God's passion. And now John turns his attention to the personal identity. People were confused about who he was and confused about who this coming Messiah was. So he addresses personal identity in verse 31, and he makes it very clear. The one who comes from above is above all, but the one who is from the earth is earthly and speaks in earthly terms. That's himself. But he states it again in verse 31, the one who comes from heaven is above all. John's making it very clear he's only the messenger. John is from the earth while Jesus is from heaven. And then these following verses, he brings forth some very specific aspects of Jesus' personal identity. And we're just going to brush over them very quickly, but there's a lot here. Verse 32, he testifies to what he's seen and heard, yet no one accepts his testimony. The one who has accepted his testimony has affirmed that God is true, for God sent him. and he speaks God's words, since he gives the Spirit without measure. The Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hands. Verse 36, the one who believes in the Son has eternal life. Did you see it? I mean, you can underline those things. Verse 34, he's sent by God. He speaks God's words. That's what Jesus did. He gives the Spirit without measure. He's loved by the Father, and then here's the gospel. He offers eternal life to those who believe. This is huge. These are important aspects of who Jesus is. And today people are confused about who Jesus is. So you know, in the first century, before they had the New Testament describing him, trying to reveal him, they were very confused. But John makes it clear that that's where they needed to put their attention. That's where their belief needed to be focused, that Jesus is the one who could offer eternal life. And that's what we have to focus on constantly. Because if you made that decision 10 or 20 or 30 or 40 minutes ago or 40 years ago, as soon as you forget that apart from Christ's sacrifice, you are eternally lost, then living gets whacked out. Our priorities change. Our values change quickly. Then it becomes all about us. I must increase. He decreases. And we start to get frustrated when people don't conform to my agenda for the world, right? So we need to remember our standing with God through Christ every day. John was just the attendant. Jesus is the bridegroom. John was from earth, Jesus is from heaven. John would decrease, Jesus is still increasing today as people around the world hear this good news and respond to it. So he tries to make it very clear who he is and who Jesus is. This testimony, this witness from John ends up resulting in his death. The other gospels relate how he upset Herod, how he was thrown into prison and eventually beheaded. John the Baptist had a purpose to prepare the way. He understood something of God's passion for his people, and then he tries to clarify, make very distinct the personal identity of who the Savior is. And this picture of the bridegroom and his passion for his people is picked up again and again in Scripture. And we find over in the book of Revelation, the last book of the Bible, that it's picked up again. In Revelation, Jesus is once again revealed as the bridegroom of the church. And here's what we read in Revelation 19. Then I heard something like the voice of a vast multitude, like the sound of cascading waters and like the rumbling of loud thunder, saying, "Hallelujah, because our Lord God, the Almighty, has begun to reign. So let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, because the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has prepared herself." Who is the bride? Followers of Jesus Christ. Who is the groom? Jesus, who is returning. And what do we anticipate? A great wedding feast. How does the bride adorn herself? Verse 8, she was given fine linen to wear, bright and pure, for the fine linen represents the righteous acts of the saints. So he said to me, write, those invited to the marriage feast of the Lamb are fortunate. And he also said to me, these words of God are true. Many of you have already settled this relationship. Will you, like John, lay your life on the line to testify that Jesus is your Savior? Will you humble yourself like John did in such a way that you decrease as he is increasing? Because this is greatness. And that passage I shared with you from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 7, verse 28, Jesus said, I'll tell you who the greatest born among women is, from women is. It's John the Baptist. But the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he. You can be great in the kingdom of God. through a faith relationship with Jesus Christ. Let's pray. As the praise team comes to lead us in a closing song of worship, it's really an opportunity for us to reflect on what we've heard, to respond to these truths from God, given by John the Baptist through the Holy Spirit, about God's passion for his people. And the question has been raised about the personal identity of Jesus. Is he a famous prophet to you? Is he a historical teacher? Is he one who had a special relationship with God? Is he your Savior? Have you ever come to the point where you acknowledge your need for a Savior? Have you put your faith in Jesus Christ? You can in this moment. And you can ask for forgiveness knowing that Jesus provided it through his sacrifice on the cross. You can be great in the kingdom of heaven if you surrender yourself and exalt Jesus. As you do, the Holy Spirit does this work of repentance in our lives, transforming us in such a way that others will see Jesus in us. God, that's our desire. Would you be glorified as we worship you, as we reflect on these truths in the next moments. Would you stand with me, please? If we can encourage you in your relationship with Jesus in any way, if the Holy Spirit has brought to mind a challenge with regard to repentance, if you want to enter into this new relationship with Jesus, or if we can just answer questions, we're here throughout the week. We'd love to talk with you. I'm around most of the day today. In fact, I'm going to be remaining right down here in the front, over on this side, available to pray with you, hear how God's working in your life. Let's remind each other of our mission as a church before we go out into the world. We want to be engaging Jesus and others every day for eternal impact. See you next time.